meeting of Cape Elizabeth. This is our seventh meeting for the 91-92 year. At this point in time, I would like to ask for a roll call by the town clerk.
Chairman Creelman?
Here.
Counselor Amaro?
Here.
Counselor Cogswell?
Here.
Counselor Chapel?
Yep.
Counselor Jordan?
Yeah.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Here.
And Counselor Pearson?
Here.
Would you please join me with the Pledge of Allegiance to our flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
At this point, I would ask for acceptance of the minutes of meeting number six of the town council held September 9th, 1991.
So moved.
Second.
We have it moved and seconded. All those in favor? All those in favor? Thank you. It's unanimous. And at this point in time, we would like to have citizens' discussion of items not formally on our agenda this evening. Are there individuals in the audience this evening that would like to discuss a particular topic not on the agenda? Please come forward. Seeing none, I will move to reports and correspondence. Fellow counselors, activity over the last month. Counselor Pearson.
Chairman Creelman, a couple things. Earlier this month, I attended a Maine Municipal Association meeting in Augusta, which was basically a preview of coming attractions of some of the items that will be on this year's legislature, which is a lot of them is a carryover from last year. There will be some more interesting and relevant information relative to recycling, which will be presented by myself or the town manager as that information is made available. Also, the Town Center Planning Committee has met a couple times already, and we've got a real good group, interesting group, that's going to have a lot of ideas, and there'll be a lot more details coming up on that in the near future. So I urge everyone to just be attentive to the Courier for upcoming meetings, which I think is going to be a very important part shaping the future of Cape Elizabeth.
Thank you. Councilor McLaughlin, please.
We're jostling over here. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to report that I did attend the September meeting of the COG Executive Committee, whenever it was, September 25th. We had a presentation by Bill Richards from Partners for Progress, which was a good enlightenment for us. I would say if counselors have questions about that organization, Jane Amaral is probably as good a person as anybody to talk to because she is a member of that group. Also want to bring to the council's attention that COG will be sponsoring a second annual local and state elected officials exchange right now. To the best of my knowledge, that is scheduled for, must be Wednesday, October 30th, to be held in Windham. I know that was quite successful last year. Jane, you were at that last year, and would encourage fellow counselors to attend that.
Counselor Jordan.
Thank you. I attended a meeting of the Cumberland County Jail Building Committee just recently, and everything is going very well, and it looks so the should be out to bid right off. It's not right at this time, and the bid opening should be sometime in December, and it looks like the way the economy is, we'll be in a good position for spring.
Great. Since our last meeting, I've had an opportunity to attend three meetings of the Cumberland County Budget Advisory Committee, meeting at the probate court in Portland. As numbers stand at this very moment, there is a projected county increase for fiscal year 1992, a little over 5%. Cape Elizabeth's portion of that increase, again, and I emphasize at the moment, this is before any any significant cutting ought to take place, rests at 4.18% at the present time. Luckily, I think for all of the counties, we are not going to be hit with the bond issue for the new jail, at least for fiscal year 1992. That will not be costing us any money due to the fashion in which that bond is being financed, but we will be facing a considerable increase in fiscal year 1993. But as of the moment, we have several meetings scheduled before the December 15th deadline for the county budget, which would go into effect January 1st, and we'll be working very hard to scrutinize all of the various departments to try to be as fiscally responsible as we can on that committee. And secondly, I had a delightful Saturday, two Saturdays ago, at the Grange Hall over on the Sprague property, and represented the citizens of Cape Elizabeth welcoming a delegation of Russian citizens from Archangel. It was a delightful opportunity to have my English translated into Russian, line by line, and I hope our visitors had a similarly enjoyable time in their stay with us. Any other reports? Councilor McLaughlin, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would like to request from the manager a report on the status of the Scout House at 1231 Shore Road. We did take some action on that last month, and I've had some citizen queries about it.
Please,
thank you.
You're more than authorized.
Thank you. As Councilor McLaughlin mentioned, at the last council meeting, the municipal office, is also known as the council, instructed us to demolish 1231 Shore Road. Under the state statutes governing the demolition of dangerous buildings, the property owner is given 30 days within which to do the same deed themselves prior to the town stepping in and doing it. In this particular instance, we waited the 30 days, and on the 30th day, the owner of the property filed in Superior Court a Rule 80B petition, which was an appeal of the council action. I still have not seen any paperwork from our attorney. This just happened the end of last week. Where it now stands is the property owner approached the town's attorney, or the property owner's attorney approached the town's attorney, asking if the council might be willing to negotiate on possibly abandoning your vote. The property owner apparently wanted to obtain a building permit and, you know, perhaps begin work. I explained to our town attorney, Mike Hill, who works in the town attorney's office, that it was my sense from the last council meeting that the town council had given some time previous to the last council meeting in order for some work and improvements to take place, and that when the council had voted 6-1 last month, that it was fairly clear that you had a definite position, and that you felt it was a dangerous building, that it ought to be removed. So I did advise Mr. Hill of that. At this point, he was going to be encouraging the property owner to look into the possibility of whether or not they would obtain a temporary restraining order against the town from demolishing it. The reason it's in our interest for them to do that, I think as well as the property owner's interest, is that we, if we go ahead and take the building down and then we lose the court case, we're in a really awkward position. What I have asked is Jerry Daigle, our assessor, to do an updated appraisal on the building so that if we did take that action, we would in essence know what our exposure is. You know, before we do anything, I will continue to consult with the town attorney. The advantage of asking the other side to come up with a temporary restraining order action is that would expedite a hearing in Superior Court and, you know, would hopefully settle the issue very early on whether or not the court felt that the council's order last month was an appropriate action. So that, Councilor McLaughlin and other members, is essentially where it stands at this point.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. Other reports and/or correspondence? All right, seeing none, we will move on to the next item of business this evening, which is our public hearing, the only public hearing this evening, on vacating of public ways near Truendy Road. This is item number 78 on our agenda, and this is to consider vacating certain public ways in Shore Acres and take necessary action. I will defer for a moment to the town manager, and then I shall open the public hearing.
Yes, the Maine statutes, the state of Maine statutes, allow for the abandonment of paper streets that were proposed in subdivisions over the years. Usually the abandonment may be done upon the initiative of the municipal officers of the town council, or an abandonment may also take place upon the initiative of a petition by someone who may be affected by the abandonment, either a person within the subdivision or someone abutting the property. A little over a month ago, the town received a petition from Martha Kelly, who is the owner of lots U-12, 45, and 46, I believe, within the Shore Acres subdivision. They specifically asked for a section of what is listed here as Bayview Road or Bayview Drive to be abandoned, as well as a very small section of Wombeck Road extension. Essentially, it extends partway across, I was going to say the Kelly driveway, but there's another Kelly, the Paul Kelly driveway heading back out towards the intersection of Reef Road and Truendy Road. So in accordance with state statute, at last month's council meeting, the town council received the petition and set a public hearing. In addition to that, the municipal officers also initiated the possibility that as long as this was being abandoned, perhaps another section that was shown on the assessor's maps as a paper street should also be abandoned. And this particular section runs, as you're going down Reef Road, according to our property map here, it's in back of land owned by McMullen, across land owned by Nichols, the Southerners, Labos, I'm sorry if I mispronounced that, the Nisbets, and then connecting with the back end of the Pelletier lot. We had our town attorney do some research on that particular paper street, and particularly come up with a better definition so when the council went to abandon it, we would make sure it tied in with the subdivision plan at the Registry of Deeds. The town attorney's office called me late Friday, and I received in the mail today an indication from them that apparently our assessor's maps are incorrect, and that there is not a paper street along the back ends of the lots from McMullen or through that lower section of Reef Road. So, even though, it's proposed as a public hearing to abandon the paper street, the town attorney advises at this point that there's really nothing to abandon, that our maps are wrong and that the action is unnecessary. Subsequent to last month's meeting, the town council also received a number of letters, which could probably be defined as a petition, from some folks who live up in the Highview Road section of the Eastfield subdivision, as well as from Truendy Point. I believe some of those folks are here tonight. And they were suggesting that that Bayview Road be extended and a portion of what some call Katahdin Road Extension be abandoned, as well as the original Kelly proposal. According to, and there's one very colorful petition here received from a Penelope Carson that shows it all on a map. But anyway, by process, if you wish to expand the area to be vacated, you do need to hold an additional public hearing. Under the state statute, you can't provide for an abandonment of a way without a public hearing. And if you haven't provided for announcement that you're planning to abandon that, then you can't do it by just adding it. What I will suggest, and I'll do it before the public hearing so people can react to it if they think it's poor judgment on my part. What I'd like to suggest that you deal separately with the Martha Kelly petition. And if you're, you know, inclined to approve that you do it this evening, separate and apart from the Katahdin Road and Bayview Extension, and that we simply handle that as a separate public hearing that perhaps you could schedule next month. You know, there may be some folks here who don't want to see the issue separated, but, you know, I wanted to say that up front so they could react to, you know, what my recommendation is going to be to the council. So that's essentially where it stands now. Notices were sent to all of the property owners in the Shore Acre subdivision in accordance with state statute, as well as to the folks who are in that lower section that seem to have a paper street running through their area. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, so for the benefit of the council, essentially our sheet on item number 78, entitled Notice of Petition to Vacate a Portion of Bayview Road and a Portion of Wambeck Road. If you follow down on that sheet to paragraph number 3, there's a 3-sentence paragraph, that would be the paragraph that would be deleted based on our town attorney's counsel to delete that paragraph. Just so we're all clear about that before I open the public hearing.
And we would correct our assessor's map accordingly as well.
That's right. All right, at this point then I will open the public hearing on item 78 and ask at this particular time if anyone in the audience would like to come to the podium and state their name and their address and their feelings about this item. Please come right up.
My name is Jim Kelly, 44 Trundy Road, and I'm representing my wife and myself. My wife owns the property. Mr. Chairman, members of the council, I was glad to hear all of what Mike had to say, because I originally agreed to pay legal fees, so I can see that I'm either going to pay a lot or it's going to be shared among some of us. In any event, you will recall that we originally came in and asked you to vacate a portion of Bayview and Wambeck that borders our property. And I emphasized last month that what we were particularly interested in having you consider, if you weren't inclined to go further than this, was to at least consider eliminating that portion of Bayview that divides our property, in other words, divides lot 45 and 46. We originally proposed that portion of those two paper streets that border our property be vacated, only because we thought that it would be appropriate to start somewhere. You will recall that you considered expanding that thought, and frankly, my wife and I support that thought of the council. If, however, this causes any of our neighbors or friends or anybody else concern or they feel it's an issue, we are not looking to create anything of that nature, and we would be very happy to back down to just that portion that separates our property if that would be the council's wish. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Kelly. Are there others who would like to come forward at this time to speak to this issue? Would any of the other Shore Acre residents like to come forward?
I'm not used to speaking at a microphone, but I'm Elizabeth Darling, and I own the lot 44 next to the Kellys. And I would be perfectly happy to have that part behind my property, the paper road, extinguished. So that would be that part of the adjoining land to Kelly's below, as far as I'm concerned. But I do think that the map is incorrect also, because there used to be another road out between our property that circled around like the Reef Road circle there. It wasn't just straight like that. So I wanted to be sure that it was done on the basis of the, when the lines are drawn, it was taken into consideration. If you're going to do the rest of Bayview Road, and I don't know whether anybody's here from the Kellys on the other side of me, we're surrounded by Kellys up there, if there's anybody here, because they are summer people. And if you were going to do all of Bayview, then I would suggest that it ought to be done all at once, and you oughtn't to just stop sort of dead on, not finish the job.
Thank you very much for that input. Other voices to this issue this evening. We have a very colorful map and a very colorful former counselor, Penelope Carson. Please give us your views.
Well, I'm getting a lot of encouragement to say something, but I'm not too sure what. And I keep thinking, what do you want me to say? I guess maybe I'm here for clarification. You are going to deal just with the Kelly petition, and that is your plan, and then you're going to take the rest of it that has been recommended by these citizens, set the time for the public hearing, and have another public hearing to vote on that. Is that as I understood it? Did I understand it?
Not exactly. There have been suggestions to extend this vacating process this evening, and unfortunately, we can't do that because the public hearing did not include the Bayview and Katahdin extension area. So we'd be very happy to deal with the Kelly's petition, which has gone through the appropriate channels and appropriate public hearing has been called. But if there was an extension to the vacating of this area, it would need to be done through an additional public hearing next month, and we would need a formal request by someone to have that take place. Is that?
Yeah, we do have a formal request. That's not a problem.
Do we have a formal agreement to pay the costs?
No, in the case of the Kellys, what I did was spoke to them afterward, and they agreed. And you know, in this case, you know, I would go, and you know, we're only talking about $150. And as long as, you know, what I would do is approach all these folks who have signed the petition or a letter, and you know, before we sent all the notices and went to the expense and the ad hearing, just to make sure that we were covered for the total cost of it. And you know, if five of them agree, and you know, it would be $30 a piece, if you know, whatever the number, as long as they had a guarantee of the total cost.
Okay.
That would,
so the people be asked to participate up to $150 to send a letter to all the people in the subdivision again, telling them that you are now going to review the possible vacating of the rest of Bayview and the Katahdin extension.
That is correct.
At the next public hearing.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
I've got my orders here.
Other input on item number 78. Seeing none, at this point I will close the public hearing and open this issue up for discussion to my fellow councilors. Councilor McLaughlin, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I strongly support the manager's recommendation this evening. I think the Kellys have gone through the processes. I certainly understand why we are eliminating section number 3 from what was advertised to people. I don't believe that we did that, put that in as a recommendation by any arbitrary move. It certainly appeared at the time when we were going in the best information we had available to us that that was an extension, a viable extension, and it looked like the properties down there were being separated by the paper street, just as the Kelly's property is being separated by the paper street. So I think, you know, we're on good grounds to correct the tax assessor's map and not deal with that section, as the town attorney recommends. So I said the Kellys have gone through the process. I have not heard from any of their neighbors or the abutters of the requested part of Bayview that came from the Kellys that there's a problem with vacating that section of it. And I think it's very appropriate to deal with the rest of this as a separate issue when we get to that point. I would have a concern about, I don't know exactly what the conditions are. Penny, what lot number are you on this map? 38, not 38A or anything, 38. Okay. I cannot picture in my mind's eye right now, maybe Counselor Chapel or somebody else in that neighborhood could help out, is what I would need to know, would want to know, is if that Katahdin extension that's labeled and colored in brown on a map that I have is in fact existing. Is that an access way? It looks like...
No.
You're saying no. Okay. Because I would not want to cut off even a private access way and make what is labeled here as a private way a dead end, because I know that's basically a drive area that is passable by car. I have driven along part of that. And I just don't know the conditions of the part in my map that are colored in brown. So I think it's very, you know, those are questions I would have if we do decide to separate that out as a separate public hearing, possibly next month. But I have no problems with the Kelly's request at this point. I think we've gone through, have not heard any complaints about it, and I would be in favor of granting the vacation request that they made.
Thank you. Other input? Counselor Pearson?
I just wanted a clarification. How many, or maybe the town manager knows, how many lots total? I mean, I came up roughly 11 to 12 lots, if you consider East Fields, and it might be involved in the paper streets on both sides, maybe 15.
It's, I don't know the exact number. It's just roughly that. But,
right.
You know, technically, by statute, everyone is the subdivision.
Okay.
Below the,
oh, and then one other question. Could the petitioner withdraw his petition and resubmit it in combined with the other petitioners? And the only reason I asked that to Mr. and Mrs. Kelly, I didn't know what your timeline was, and monetary, as the town manager alluded to, it's not that great, but if you packaged it all together and you had 20 together and you all split the cost, it might save you in the long run. But as I said, I'm not proposing that anyone save any money, because it's not vast sums of money. But if you wanted to package it, once again, I'm not sure what your maybe you can clarify.
I'd be happy to have you come up, Mr. Kelly, and respond to this suggestion.
Just for a clarification.
Thank you. I would prefer not to.
Okay.
We've attended two
mm-hmm.
meetings now and would hope that the council would deal with our issue. I do not know what your map looks like, and therefore don't even know what area it is that you're talking about extending. So I don't even know if it's something that we would have an interest in or support or even oppose. If it, the other thing is, my understanding is that you need to be reasonably current with respect to the notification of property owners, and whether or not your new petition now is going to require a new visit to the registry and a review of another 112 owners or whatnot. But we've already gone through that process and would prefer not to do that again.
Okay. No, I just wanted to
thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Other input on this issue? Councilor Jordan.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I'm in full agreement of moving ahead of what we have put in the paper and advertised as for a public hearing. The only question I have, and I could raise it next time around, on Katahdin extension, that it doesn't interfere with anybody, and if maybe somebody can answer my question, is 4 and 4A, is that two lots or is that combined now? My map puts it as two lots, and by abandoning Katahdin extension, whether that affect that 4A.
I'm not, well, Penny, can you answer that? Although it's not going to pertain to the motion this evening, I'd be happy for clarification to take place.
I'd be happy to tell you what the owner of lot number 4 was. Mr. Hobby told me that he's happy to support the vacating of the Bayview and Katahdin extension as soon as he finds out who owns lot 4A.
Thank you. Thank you.
He has no recollection of owning it. He doesn't want to raise the issue because he doesn't want to pay taxes.
Thank you, Pat. Yeah, we can check. We can find the true owner fairly easily. Other input? Seeing none, I would entertain a motion at this time.
Mr. Chairman?
Councilor Chapel.
I move that we support the vacating of the public way given to us by Martha Kelly.
Second.
OK. Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion on this item? Mr. Manager?
Yeah, I just wanted to question if the council, as part of this motion or as a separate motion, wanted to schedule a public hearing on the petition to...
Looks like we should vote on it.
I think that should be a separate motion.
I just didn't want to...
Should be a second motion.
Left, because I didn't know what to do.
Get one out of the way.
Do we want to consider this motion A and the other would be B?
No, no.
Entirely separate.
Yeah.
Very fine. We have a motion. We have a second. All those in favor? It's a unanimous vote, 7-0. Is anyone interested in proposing a second motion at this time?
My question is, can we propose a second motion? You said we have enough letters or requests in? Yes. Well, I would propose a second motion that whatever letters and so forth you have, that we have a public hearing for additional extensions in the area for our November meeting.
So specifically, we would ask for the extending this vacating of Bayview Road to include the Katahdin Road extension, but not the section on U-13. Is there a second on that motion?
Second motion.
Excuse me, is there some confusion?
And also the further extension of Bayview.
Further extension of Bayview, right. I think do we all have the brown shaded, color-coded area?
Very helpful.
That's what we're talking about. I'm not sure it's helpful for anyone out there, but we know what we're talking about. Okay, we have a motion, we have a second. Discussion.
I would like to, if Mr. Chappell's agreeable, to amend his motion to read a public hearing set Wednesday, November 13th, 1971 at 7:30.
So noted the clarification in terms of the date of the public hearing. Councilor McLaughlin?
Just a question. Is it understood with this motion that the petitioners will guarantee the expenses that are going to be incurred by the town, number one, the legal notice, and number two, the mailing of public hearing notices? Is that to the entire owners throughout the subdivision, I believe?
That, and we'd also have to send a few additional ones to the abutters who are...
To the Highview.
On Highview.
Thanks.
So that's understood. Other clarifications, Councilor Jordan?
I just don't want it. I like the idea of trying to go get the money, but I don't want it. If he didn't receive the amount of money, that it wouldn't come up on the agenda and we'd have a chance to vote on it. I don't want the money issue to kill the motion.
Mr. Chairman, it's my understanding that it's incumbent upon the applicants, petitioners, whoever, to finance this. I believe the way the statute is written, the town should not have to come up with any funds for this because it's going to happen anyway in 1997. If they want to wait that long, they can do so without going through this process. If they want it done now, I expect them to pay for it. A typical condition is the public hearing does not happen unless the ad runs, and the ad does not run unless they pay for it.
Well, that's my understanding. If the fee would not be in excess of $150, which would essentially cover the mailing expenses on this particular item.
Does that also include the newspaper notice?
I believe
the manager's nodding in the affirmative.
I think as long as the town manager understands that, Councilor McLaughlin, we're all set. He'll get that money vouched for before the notices go in and so forth, I'm sure.
Okay, that's not what I was hearing from Councilor Jordan.
Yeah.
So.
Are we comfortable with this motion and the second and the discussion at this point?
Well, we like it very much.
All right. Then I will ask for a vote on it. All those in favor? We have a unanimous vote. Okay, so that we will have a public hearing next month. And again, next month, the town council meeting will be on a Wednesday, November 13th, celebrating Veterans Day, of course, on that Monday that we would otherwise have met, November 13th, 1991 at 7:30 at the Town Hall. Thank you very much. Okay, the next item on this evening's agenda is item number 79. This is to consider a letter from the town attorney regarding concurrent membership on the Conservation Commission and on the Board of Directors of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust and take any necessary action. I would remind my fellow counselors that at our January 8th, 1991 town council meeting, item number 36 was on our agenda. This was a similar item involving planning board members serving as members of the governing board of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. This was a similar item that we discussed that evening with respect to the Conservation Commission, but we decided, because the planning board was a quasi-judicial board, that we would put a hold on the Conservation Commission issue and request from our town attorney an opinion on that commission separately from the planning board. I would remind my fellow counselors that the motion passed that evening on the planning board that planning board members would not concurrently serve as members of the governing board of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. That was a 5-2 vote in the affirmative. Subsequent to that vote, I did receive a letter from John Roberts, the chairman of the Conservation Commission, with respect to the process that we went through regarding that vote. And we did, I did let Mr. Roberts know that prior to our voting and discussing this issue this evening with respect to the conflict of interest with planning board members, excuse me, with Conservation Commission members who served on the governing group of the land trust, that we would certainly alert him to our discussion and any proposed vote on this issue. I did request a legal opinion from our town attorney, Mr. Leahy, and I received a response from him on August 30th, 1991, of which all of my fellow counselors should have been able to review at this point. I requested an opinion concerning potential conflicts of interest when a Conservation Commission member sits as a director of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. Mr. Leahy spelled out the issues of what conflict of interest involve, as he had in his prior correspondence with respect to the planning board, and did feel that Conservation Commission members ought to be included under the Maine state statutes, in that every municipal official shall have a duty to avoid the appearance of a conflict of interest by disclosure or abstention. And Mr. Leahy also underscored the fact that the town council is authorized to adopt an ethics policy governing the conduct of elected and appointed municipal officials. He also reiterated the fact that any determination of a conflict of interest would obviously need to be made on a case-by-case basis, and unfortunately this is not always a clear-cut issue. With respect to the Conservation Commission members in particular, his opinion was that any conflict would most likely arise if an individual was biased in carrying out his or her duties for the two bodies. That is, if a person is an official of both the Land Trust and the Conservation Commission, he or she could be clearly torn between recommending the town council accept a donation of a parcel of land or attempting to have that same parcel of land donated to the land trust. And unfortunately, this issue could arise every time a developer pursued a subdivision project in Cape Elizabeth. So that his advice to us was that there did appear to be a conflict of interest when a Conservation Commission member also sits on the land trust governing board, whenever the issue presented related to transfers of land to either the town or the land trust takes place, because that person, he or she, would be in the position of serving potentially two masters, such that it was his advice to the town council to adopt an ethics policy which would prohibit one who is a director of the land trust from being appointed to the Conservation Commission, thus removing any potential conflict of interest. And this is the issue that we have before us this evening. I do see Mr. Roberts here, and I would ask him if he cares to come forward and speak to this item before I ask my fellow councilors to discuss the issue.
Thank you, Mr. Grillman, members of the town council. My name is Jack Roberts. I guess my feelings are that a problem doesn't exist and that you're trying to solve one, and I'm concerned that in the process you may be offending somebody who has served the town of Cape Elizabeth faithfully for a number of years, and I would hope that you would be very careful in your deliberations and use good judgment on how you decide to do this. I'm speaking not as a chairman of the Conservation Commission, but as a member of that board. We have not met and had a formal vote on what position we would take. But that's my concern, that I don't see a problem, and I hope you'd be careful on, you know, not offending somebody.
Thank you, Mr. Roberts. Other members of the Conservation Commission who wish to speak to this item?
My name is Jeanette Hagen. I've served about a year and a half of a three-year term on the Conservation Commission. My experience has been that to have a member of the Land Trust and Conservation Commission together aids in the communication, and it's a benefit to have that sort of sympathetic relationship between the two organizations. I also just say that there's some ambiguities in the letter I saw in the town attorney's letter. I see that he said it may be advisable, and I just think that this is something that really needs to be looked at carefully, and I would hope that you wouldn't make a hasty decision tonight. We are not serving in any judicial capacity, and I just think this needs to be looked at carefully so that you don't you avoid disturbing people who might want to be on the commission and might find themselves in a conflict. So just to look at it carefully.
Thank you, Ms. Hagen. I also see some members of the Land Trust. I'm very happy to invite you to come to the podium if you care to, and share your thoughts with us this evening.
Thank you, Councilor Creamon. Pete Rand, the Land Trust. I'll be brief. Once again, I'm disappointed and saddened at the Town Council's determination to sever all working relationships between the two bodies, the two town bodies whose actions directly affect conservation in Cape Elizabeth, and the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, the one organization by which the citizens themselves can play a major role in the preservation of open space in the town. Once again, I'm at a loss to understand what interests would be put in conflict for individuals who are dedicated to the preservation of the Cape's remaining natural beauty, regardless of what group they serve, by inhibiting the communication of conservation priorities, of long-term plans, of fleeting opportunities. You are going to make the task much more difficult, much less efficient. In our view, conservation of open space, development of the green belt, preservation of views, these have far higher priority than concern for any very unlikely and untenable challenge related to conflict of interest. Once again, I sought the informal legal opinion from the Maine Coast Heritage Trust counselor about Mr. Leahy's recommendations, and this time concern was expressed, in fact, about their constitutionality, something about their being repugnant to free association. Obviously not my words, but something that might be of interest to lawyers. Before creating such a permanent policy, perhaps the opinion of another municipal lawyer might avoid problems, if not for you, for future councils. For example, why should not-for-profit conservationists be denied membership on the Conservation Commission when for-profit developers, lawyers, accountants, contractors, etc., are not? Each may have his or her bias. They may state it, step aside, as is a long-standing routine. But each also brings his or her own particular talents, knowledge, and enthusiasm to the process, resources that far outweigh the risk of conflicts of interest. To me, however, these arguments are unimportant in comparison to the real problem, which is that Cape Elizabeth will not be able to benefit from the mutually trusting, productive open space preservation programs that exist among other land trusts in the state. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rand. Please, come right up.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Nat Clifford, Bowery Beach Road. I'm a past several-term member of the Conservation Commission and currently a director of the Land Trust. Through a long involvement with both organizations, I have learned of the benefits of a cooperation between the public and the private organizations. I honestly didn't realize at the time the Land Trust was formed 4 years ago at the same time had finished my last term of the Conservation Commission just how important this relationship is. I've seen through my years with the Conservation Commission, I've worked on almost every project that eventually yielded land donated to the town. And on the Land Trust side, I've also been involved in every either donation or purchase of property that has been acquired. And as I said, through all of these negotiations and the interplay between the town and the Land Trust, I see nothing but benefit accruing to the citizens of the town in this close cooperative relationship. Now, certainly, any such relationship could have problems. I have only heard from the council on the issue of the planning board member being also a land trust director, that the concern seemed to be a perceived conflict. And I have an intuitive feeling that this perhaps is a situation with respect to a land trust director being represented on the Conservation Commission. Perceived only. I know we've got to be squeaky clean as we operate in the public eye, but we're both after the same thing. We're trying to retain valuable open space for the use of our citizens. We have the same constituents. There is no monetary value at issue, and I see no downside other than to make sure that everything is done honestly and in an open way. I think the closer the relationship is between, for example, the Conservation Commission and the Land Trust, I think the less chance for misunderstanding there is. I read in Mr. Leahy's letter words, as Jeanette Hagen said, do not come right out and say there is a conflict. There may be, and I think there's a lot left to the people that are involved in these organizations to make sure that things don't come up that are a problem. Let me finally give you an example that came up quite recently that I think is very typical of many of the more recent acquisitions by either the town or the Land Trust of open space. Several months ago, Peter Rand, as president of the Land Trust, got a phone call from one of our local property owners asking about donating land as open space. And at the same time, he was interested in obviously taking a tax deduction for that donation. Peter's first few phone calls were to several of the directors of the Land Trust. And again, this is an often repeated pattern. I've done the same thing myself in Peter's position, to make sure that this was something that we'd be interested in participating in. He then called Jack Roberts, and ultimately, Peter and Jack Roberts and I met with a property owner to discuss first what was the property, take a look at it, and to give him some advice as to which way he might want to go. There was no discussion of arm wrestling with Jack as to whether it goes to the town or goes to the land trust. We don't care. I don't think Jack cares, and I don't think you care. I think you simply want the land to be acquired as open space for the use and enjoyment of our citizens. It everybody wins. The town benefits, the citizens benefit. And again, I think if we've got to operate at arm's length, sure, we can do it. What we'll probably have to do is to send representatives of the land trust to every Conservation Commission and Planning Board meeting so that we can keep a hand on the pulse of what's going on. We're not building an empire. We're not feeding our egos. We're simply trying to preserve open space. And I think the closer we can work, the more effective we can be. And I fail to see where there's a conflict, where there's no money or sale or exchange of property involved. And if we're not smart enough to avoid a perception of a conflict, then I don't think any of us ought to be operating the public eye at all. I think this opens up a situation whereby any property owner in town would be suspect if they served on any commission or board or elected position in town. There's automatically a conflict there, and Lord knows we certainly have to overcome those. Please, consider carefully what Peter said and the points I've tried to raise. And perhaps at least give us an opportunity to meet with the Conservation Commission and apply the thinking that I think we've gained over the years. Many of us on the Land Trust Board and our members have been on both sides of this. And with all due respect, none of you has actually been in those contexts. And let us talk. Let your Conservation Commission make a recommendation to you. And I think out of that process, perhaps a clearer understanding might arise. I certainly would hope so. Maybe I'll learn something. I could be totally off base, but I'm so sure that this is a terrible mistake that I hope you'll consider and give this thing a chance to work itself out. We certainly, speaking for our directors, and I think many that have been involved in attempting to preserve open space in the Cape, would certainly contribute whatever time and thought would be necessary to get into a dialogue and hopefully come out of this with a clearer thought than just a fear of a perception and an unfortunate reaction. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Clifford. Other input from either Conservation Commission members or Land Trust members? Okay, seeing none, I will open, actually not a public hearing, I would ask for input from my fellow councilors on this issue. Quiet group tonight on this particular issue. Well, as I see it, a couple of issues that come to my mind are the following. The first is that I think the issue is the issue involves a member of the Conservation Commission serving as a member of the governing body of the Land Trust versus, you know, being a member of the Land Trust. I'm not sure what the statistics are, but many of us here on the council are members of the Land Trust. To my knowledge, none of us are in the governing body. So I think there's a difference between being on the governing body versus being a member of the Land Trust. That's one issue. I guess the second issue is really the issue of who gets the land. I agree with all of what is said from the point of view that, yes, we are attempting to acquire land that would continue to be used for the benefit and the enjoyment of the public. Whether the town officially receives that land or the land trust receives that land, I would like to be crystal clear about the difference in each of those bodies having acquired that particular land parcel. And having asked that question out loud, I see our town manager is probably going to be meandering back here to the council bench to comment on this particular issue. Mr. McGovern, I do see you back there. I was going to ask for a bit of a clarification and a little help in this regard, because this seemingly is I think the crux of a couple of these issues. So I'm going to ask Mr. McGovern to respond to that question. That question, Mr. McGovern, is exactly what is the difference between the town acquiring the land opposed to the land trust acquiring the land?
They're two separate organizations. It's the difference between you owning land and me owning land. It's owned by one party instead of another. Regardless of what party it goes to, there are generally conservation restrictions on the land when it goes to the land trust or to the town through the Conservation Commission procedure. There might be a difference in priorities of the Conservation Commission and the land trust on what those particular restrictions should be in working with the property owner. But to my knowledge, up to this point in time, there never has been any difference on that. They've followed fairly similar paths.
And
so the difference, essentially, to answer your question, is the difference between you and I owning land. It's just one party owns it and one doesn't.
And there's no difference from the point of view of monetary issues and tax roll issues?
There's a slight difference in that all the land that's owned by the town is not taxable. It's tax exempt. Land that is owned by the land trust is taxed at a value that reflects the restrictions on the land. It's generally taxed at a very low level, but it is in fact taxed.
So in effect, land that would go to the land trust would be income producing to the town?
It would produce tax revenue.
Councillor Jordan.
I'd like to follow up on a question to the manager about, is there any benefit to the donor other than a contractor as far as taxes go, whether it goes to land trust or to the town?
From strictly a financial point of view, no. The land trust has held at different times, though I didn't hear it tonight, that there is a difference in that the town process is sometimes not as responsive in reference to timing. If they get a call on December 28th, they can usually quickly get a board together by December 31st to effect an arrangement. If someone makes a proposal to the council, we'd go to the Conservation Commission, we'd call a council meeting, and we generally can't act within 2 or 3 days. We can, but it's more difficult than it is perhaps for the land trust.
If I may, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to add another question.
Oh, indeed, please.
You said it's tax producing to the town, so if there's some land giving purchased or turned over to the land trust one way or another, and we put a conservation easement on it, does that affect the value as far as what is produced to the town?
Yes, it does.
It does affect.
Yeah, generally, the more restrictions that there are on the use of land, the lower its value.
But I think, to me, we're getting away from the issue of the item on the agenda, and I appreciate what Mr. Clifford had to say, and also Peter Rand. And I think the way I look at the problem, I felt we had a problem as far as the planning board was concerned, and I think my point in following through with this is to let's review both Conservation Land Trust Planning Board and see if we can correct it all at one time instead of a piecemeal type basis. And I'm in favor of taking a hard look at it all before I make any recommendation.
Councilor Coxall.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I do have another question for Mr. McGovern.
Do you think I was going to have any questions on this?
During the process of land being given either to the town or the land trust, a representative of the Conservation Commission meets with the same group. Is that correct? You all sort of go out and look at the parcel that may be donated. Who accepts it for the town if it's going to be given to the town? Makes the initial commitment?
Well, there is a discussion period that goes on with the planning board. They generally refer it to the Conservation Commission. The Conservation Commission has discussions with the developer. Usually the town attorney becomes involved at that point, the attorney for the developer, and a conveyance document is prepared. At the time, that usually then goes back to the planning board, and then there's always a point in every subdivision where an approach is made to the council and whether or not you're willing to accept the public improvements within a subdivision. Usually when that approach is made is at the same time you are asked to agree to accept whatever the offered conveyance is. So it's a process that eventually reaches the council, but most of the nitty-gritty work of it is done by the Conservation Commission, working with the town attorney and working with other interested parties. And that's when it goes to the town, if it goes to the land trust. It's a very similar process, and usually the Conservation Commission is involved as well. However, the property owner decides for their own reasons they prefer for it to go to the land trust.
So the preliminary acceptance of the land for the town is done through the Conservation Commission?
It's a preliminary review. I the acceptance is...
If it's something that they don't feel we want, then they tell them no initially, right?
It's not quite... It goes through a lot of give and take. There was a recent Peter Kennedy with the Greater Portland Development Group went through a process, and at one point he did offer to the land trust. The land trust said that it wasn't in keeping with their acquisition goals, and that they felt it might be more appropriate. I don't want to put words in their mouth, but they felt that going back to the planning board, it developed anyway that it went to the town. And it went to the council. Did I answer your question?
It's just that in the past I've always heard, well, the Conservation Commission accepted this donation of land. That's the way it's always been phrased to us.
Yeah.
And so
it's phrased that way, but the council is the legal entity that
finally,
accepts
months later
property and for the community.
I guess I have a clarification that I need to be clear about. I'm picturing, this landowner out in the middle of the field with a member of the Conservation Commission and a member of the Land Trust, and they're all talking about what to do with this land. But, I mean, who really, sets up, if you give the land to the town, this happens. If you give the land to the Conservation, to the Land Trust, this happens. And all of the pros and cons and the tax advantages and... I mean, who is there anyone who ever actually does that?
Yeah, up to this point, I would say it's fair to say that the Land Trust and the Conservation Commission have worked very cooperatively in that regard. There's a joint discussion.
And are you...
That's fair.
For example, I don't want to bring it up, but there have been some people who don't want to have the town responsible for the conservation of their land, and therefore they want to give it to the land trust specifically. There are other issues in which, were we to accept the land, it would be a liability to us with respect to potential tax liability because of restrictions that the donor has put on the land. That was the case of Mr. Kennedy, who wanted to retain the right to put the trails entries on his land if he insisted on that would have represented an increased tax liability for us if we wanted to claim an exemption. These are complex things, but there are definite reasons for many of these transactions to go one way or the other. It, as Nat said, is irrelevant to us, just as long as the land is preserved one way or the other. And there are things that we can do the town can't do, and vice versa.
Mr. Roberts.
If I might add to that, I think the Conservation Commission is primarily concerned in grabbing parcels of land that pertain more to the green belt and maybe larger parcels of property that people want to donate that have a tax value. The land trust can take those and then pay the taxes on them. So again, it's a cooperative venture, and it's not that people out there fighting over a piece of land. In fact, the parcel that Nate was talking about was, I think, our final recommendation was they talk with the, help me out, what is it?
Rachel.
Rachel Carson people. We felt there was that would be the better entity, but because of the holdings around it, than either one of us would be. And so it's not really an issue on which of us gets the land. If it's Greenbelt, the Conservation Commission will probably say, yes, we'd like to have it. If it's an open parcel, has some tax value, these folks would probably be the better people to get it and keep it on the tax rolls.
Councilor Amaral.
Jack, couldn't the system work just as well without a member of the Conservation Commission serving as a director on the land trust? I mean, couldn't you still have that cooperation and joint consulting without
personally,
having that
yes, I think we could. I guess it's like the old Downey saying, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And I think that's what seems to be trying to be done here. We've got good cooperation, and I'm afraid that, you know, we're going to be hurting people that have put in a lot of years of service for I'm not sure what apparent reason.
Well, I think if that's the issue, is hurting people who are presently serving both
it's
positions.
It's further than that. I think Peter and Nat really explained it further than I tried to on that end. I guess as a member of the Conservation Commission, I don't want to get into policy. That's what you people have to define. I just wanted to know from my standpoint it wasn't a problem. You've got to make the decision.
Well, when we had this discussion the last time around, when we were considering at that time both the role of planning board members as well as Conservation Commission members serving on the board of the land trust, at that night we deferred action on the Conservation Commission until we got a legal opinion as to whether that board had the type of responsibility which might possibly be in conflict with the town statutes on how land would be, that had to be dedicated, on how that land would be parceled out, whether it would go to the town or the land trust or some other organization. And I think the opinion that we got, for me, was pretty clear that, like the planning board issue, that it is also an issue for Conservation Commission members to serve in both capacities, because of the fact that if a person is on the board of the land trust and on the Conservation Commission, they may not be as open to making a decision that would give equal weight to all of the options available. That to me is the possibility of a conflict. Well, you say we haven't experienced it yet. I see the potential for that happening. And I think for purposes of being consistent and making some sense out of the policies that we have, if we've already decided that the planning board members should not serve as directors, I think it only makes sense, given this legal opinion, that we do the same with Conservation Commission members. However, I would propose that if we do that, that we exclude present Conservation Commission members who are already serving in both capacities during this term of their office on the Conservation Commission.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I agree with Councilor Amaral's last statement in particular about not affecting anybody currently serving on the Conservation Commission. I certainly have, and I think all of us on this council have tremendous respect for all the people that we and councils preceding us have appointed to that commission. And if we do get to a point where we are taking action on this, I would only be supportive of it if we say that we are not affecting anybody in their current term on the Conservation Commission. I share the question. It's been going through my mind. I've been trying to grapple with this. This is why I think, you know, some of us perhaps, especially myself, were so silent after the comments from the audience this evening. Heard, you know, very positive comments about the good, close, cooperative working relationship that exists right now between our Conservation Commission and the Land Trust, and I certainly do not want to see that relationship undermined. I totally agree with you, Nat, that it's the town and the citizens who benefit from that kind of working relationship. I remain unconvinced, however, that you need to have, you know, I guess that's what it has sounded like, that you need to have a member of the board of directors from the land trust on the Conservation Commission. I'm not convinced that that's the only workable way to have that kind of relationship that is so beneficial. You may have to attend more public meetings as a land trust director to maintain your knowledge of what's going on. I think that's going to happen anyway. It's possible, you know, conceivable with a director of the land trust on Conservation Commission that you're only getting that person's input on from both sides, and I don't think that's fair to either organization. I think you need more than one person's input. That can certainly be done if you have a rotating membership, a rotating assignment for land trust members to attend Conservation Commission meetings and planning board meetings or some, you know, set it up like that. That's administrative. That can be done. And I think that's a way to maintain the benefits of the relationship between the two entities. I do take issue with a couple of statements in the letter we have from our town attorney where it's stated that if a person is an official, it says an official of both the Land Trust and Conservation Commission. The only official, quote unquote, we have the Conservation Commission, I believe, is the president. The chairman of the Conservation Commission. We don't really have officials. That's done by a consensus vote there. It says, as an official of both, he or she would be torn between recommending. I think he or she could be torn, but I'm not sure they essentially would be torn. And the issue does come down to when a Conservation Commission member sits as a land trust director, not as a land trust member. So I think there were some holes, perhaps, some flaws in some of the statements made by the town attorney. It's been commented on about the fact that this is a perceived conflict of interest, and I know many of us, most of us in the room, the majority of us certainly, have been in situations in our professional capacity and in our volunteer capacity where we may have had to step down from discussion and voting on an issue because of a perceived conflict. And that, in many people's minds, is just as real as an actual conflict. And that's something that we have to be so careful of avoiding. I think the council is very good about doing that, and we certainly are setting a standard that I expect board and commission members in this town to follow. I don't know if I want to get into an ethics policy, but, you know, that's my a personal ethics policy, and I certainly expect that to be followed. It's not always easy to know when there is a perceived conflict, and if we can decrease the number of instances of that, I think we're doing ourselves a favor. There are a lot of issues. I really have taken to heart the comments that you folks have made this evening. I'm not sure if I'm ready to vote one way or another on this. And part of it is because, yes, I favored the vote we had fairly recently about the planning board members, the town planning board members, not being a member of the board of directors of the land trust. Planning board members serve in a quasi-judicial capacity, which is very different from the advisory capacity that the conservation members serve in. I'm still grappling with it, quite frankly, to make a long story short.
Input, Councilor Jordan.
I don't know as I can add too much to it, what I've already said earlier, but I will say I'm in agreement with what Councilor Amaral threw out, that if a policy is made, that it doesn't affect the present officers, and when their term expires, and then it would go into effect. That's the way I would go along with it, and I really think, in my opinion, that we should do something for the future. I have no qualms with what's going on now, but we got to sit here and look into the future, in my opinion. same as we did with the planning board.
Councilor Amaral.
I'd like to move that we add a Section 9 to the statement of policy, town council policy regarding the appointments to committees. That section would read, members of the Conservation Commission may not concurrently serve as members of the governing board of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. This does not include present Conservation Commission members who serve in both capacities.
Second motion.
Okay, we have a motion and we have a second. Is there further discussion? All right, I would ask the town clerk for a roll call vote, please.
Chairman Krillman?
Yes.
Councilor Amaral?
Yes.
Councilor Cogswell?
Yes.
Councilor Chapel?
Yes.
Councilor Jordan?
Yes.
Councilor McLaughlin?
Yes.
And Councilor Pearson?
No.
Okay, the motion carries on a vote of 6-1. Item number 80 this evening is to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding ordinance amendments relating to affordable housing and taking any necessary action. I will defer at this time to the chair of our Ordinance Committee, Councilor Cogswell.
Thank you. The draft housing affordable housing amendment that we have before us tonight is the culmination of many years of hard work. Beginning, I believe, as early as 1986, there was a joint committee funded with state money of Yarmouth and Cape Elizabeth to start investigating drawing up affordable housing ordinances. And following that, the growth management legislation from the state Maine legislature has decreed that all municipalities shall have a goal to provide affordable, decent housing opportunities for all Maine citizens. The municipality shall seek a level of 10% of new residential development meeting the definition of affordable housing price criteria. And as a result of that, in February 1989, the Cape Elizabeth Affordable Housing Committee proposed a draft. And I'm going to read the conclusion, part of the conclusion. Even though these are difficult economic times, I believe the conclusions are still true as they were in 1987 and 1989. That Cape Elizabeth citizens are very proud of their community. It's a wonderful place to live with great natural beauty and excellent schools. But Cape Elizabeth must maintain a healthy socioeconomic mix to thrive. Building permanently affordable housing in Cape Elizabeth will ensure a dynamic social environment for the future. And we are trying to look forward in a lot of the actions that we're taking as a town council. And we believe having an affordable housing ordinance in place will be prepared when more development requests come before the planning board. And so I will now read the proposed housing amendments. Section 19-1-3 under definitions. Affordable housing. Lots/units which may be purchased for occupancy by buyers with low and moderate incomes as published by the State Office of Comprehensive Planning or the Greater Portland Council of Governments. A definition of low income. Family income which is between 50% and 80% of the median family income for the Portland Metropolitan Statistical Area as published by the State Office of Comprehensive Planning or the Greater Portland Council of Governments. A definition for moderate income. Family income which is between 80% and 150% of median family income for the Portland Metropolitan Statistical Area as published by the State Office of Comprehensive Planning or the Greater Portland Council of Governments. Section 19-3-17. mandatory affordable housing provisions. Subsection A, the purpose. The town of Cape Elizabeth finds that the housing shortage for persons of low and moderate income is detrimental to the public health, safety, and welfare, in that it discourages a community rich in economic, social, and cultural diversity. It is therefore a public purpose and an objective of the comprehensive plan to make available and integrate in the town an adequate supply of housing for persons of all economic segments of the community. Subsection B, applicability. The mandatory affordable housing provisions shall apply to all major subdivisions as defined in Section 16-1-4, located in the Resident A and Resident C districts. All major subdivisions shall set aside at least 10% of the lots / units in the project as affordable housing for moderate income buyers, or 5% of the lots / units in the projects as affordable housing for low income buyers. For projects where a number of lots / units in excess of the mandatory required lots / units are set aside as affordable housing, the applicant shall be eligible for a density bonus of one additional lot / unit for each moderate income affordable lot / unit, and two additional lots / units for each low income affordable lot / unit in excess of the mandatory requirement. The following minimum lot sizes may be approved for the additional bonus lots / units. Under Zoning District A, Residence A, the minimum lot size, 30,000 square feet per lot. Residence C, 8,000 square feet per lot, provided that it is served by public sewer. Subsection C, standards. Subsection 1, affordable housing lots / units shall be sold to qualified low and moderate income buyers as defined in Section 19-1-3 and any additional criteria adopted by the Town Council. Preference shall be given first to, and this is an additional correction for the members of the Council, elderly town residents, second to other town residents, and then to employees of the Town of Cape Elizabeth. All affordable housing units shall be owner-occupied. Subsection 2, affordable housing lots / units shall be geographically dispersed throughout the development where feasible. Subsection 3, affordable housing lots / units shall be compatible with the design of the remainder of the development in the terms of appearance, materials, and finish quality. Any dwelling sited on a lot shall be located to allow the construction of a garage on the lot without requiring a setback variance. Subsection 4, the applicant shall submit for Town Council review and acceptance an agreement which preserves the long-term affordability of the lots / units to low and moderate income households. The agreement shall be either a second mortgage, deed restriction, or a combination of, we have changed that to the word two instead of the above. The applicant may use an agreement provided by the town or may present a comparable instrument for review. Agreements must include, but not be limited to, subsection small one, a proven method to preserve long-term, parentheses, 99 years, end of parentheses, affordability to the low and moderate income buyers. Small two, a formula for accruing limited equity to the buyer, which includes any physical improvements to the property. Subsection small Roman 3, the option to return housing to market rates only if there are no qualified buyers within a 24-month period of the property being listed on the market. Small Roman 4, an option to the town to purchase the affordable lots / units if no qualified buyers apply. Subsection small Roman 5, the enforceability of the mechanism. Roman small Roman 6, the amount of administrative cost to the town. And small Roman 7, the supervision of the agreement. Subsection 5, the mandatory affordable housing provision shall run with the land. Subsection 6, affordable housing lots slash units shall be constructed at least concurrently with the remainder of the project. In developments where the applicant shall construct at least 50% of the units, the building permits for the first 50% of the units of the entire development shall include all the approved affordable housing units. Subsection D, modifications and fees. Parentheses 1, for projects with less than 10 lots slash units, the applicant may propose to pay a fee in lieu of creating affordable housing. In lieu fees shall be equal to the difference between the average fair market value of the housing developed, as determined by the planning board based upon the submission by the applicant of an appraisal or equivalent information, and the maximum cost of moderate income affordable housing as defined in section 19-1-3. For projects where the developer will be selling unbuilt lots only, the maximum affordable cost shall be no more than 40% of the cost of affordable housing for low-income buyers. The fee shall be proportional to the number of lots slash units in the development. Number 2, where the planning board finds that undue hardship or environmental conditions do not make the inclusion of affordable housing feasible, the planning board may modify the affordable housing provisions in favor of a proposed alternative upon showing that it will not have the effect of nullifying the intent and objectives of the comprehensive plan or the provisions of section 19-3-17. Provided, however, that in granting a modification, the planning board may impose such conditions as it deems necessary to secure the foregoing objectives, including but not limited to the imposition of in-lieu fees as calculated in subsection 1 above and the creation of affordable housing elsewhere in the town. The reduced lot size for affordable housing, and we have minor corrections here for clarification, are only applicable in a new subdivision. This provision does not allow otherwise unbuildable lots to be developed to meet the mandatory affordable housing provisions of section 19-3-17. Subsection 3, in lieu fees shall be deposited in a municipal account dedicated to providing affordable housing. Subsection C, there will be no approval of any proposed development which exceeds the density allowable after calculating the new residential acreage of the site in accordance with the standards for multiplex housing, section 19-3-1, parentheses small a, small d, parentheses, except where all the lots slash units in the proposal shall be affordable housing as defined in section 19-1-3, in which case the standards in section 19-3-17, subsection C, shall apply, and the following densities shall be applicable. Under zoning district residence A, the units per acre minimum lot size 1.4 units, 30,000 square feet per lot. Residence C, 5.4 units per acre, minimum lot size of 8,000 square feet per lot, providing that it is served by public sewer. Subsection H, residential open space accumulated by reducing space requirements within the allowable density limits shall be usable for common recreation or outdoor living purposes, or for preserving large trees, tree groves, woods, ponds, streams, glens, rock outcrops, native plant life, and wildlife cover. The use of such common open space may be further limited or regulated by imposition of reasonable conditions by the planning board at the time of final plat approval, but only where necessary to protect adjacent properties or uses. A part of or all of such common space may, at the discretion of the town council, be required to be conveyed or dedicated to the town for use and operation as a municipal recreational facility. in projects where all the lots slash units shall qualify as affordable housing, a minimum of 25% of the acreage shall be dedicated as open space in the RC zone, and a minimum of 50% of the acreage shall be dedicated as open space in the RA zone. Mr. Chairman, this is the result of many months of very hard work by our town planner and the planning board, and 2 months of the ordinance committee. We also have our planner, Maureen O'Meara, here if there are any particular questions for the council on certain sections of the ordinance.
Thank you very much, Councillor Cogswell. It indeed is another great work of ordinance language.
Thank you.
And we're very proud of all those individuals involved in this very, very lengthy but very important process. The motion this evening is going to be to set this item to public hearing in November. I'm certainly willing to ask for any clarifications from our town planner, if that is in order. If not, we'll have ample opportunity next month to debate the issue and solicit as much public input as possible at the public hearing. Councilor Cogswell.
In addition, the town council was also provided by our planner some of the current affordable housing rents and selling prices prices from 1990 in the greater Portland area. And the median annual family income was $37,300. And the affordable selling price was up to $33,100 for a house. For very low income was $60,300. And moderate income, $117,800.
I think you also read the annual income range so people know what
okay.
We're talking
the annual
about.
Income range, very low income, up to $18,650 per year. Low income, $18,650 to $29,840. And moderate income, $29,840 to $55,950.
Mm-hmm. And that is for informational purposes only. That
yes,
would not be
right.
A part of the ordinance itself, but that is for all of
well,
our.
Well, in the ordinance, we do make reference to the Portland Metropolitan Statistical.
So will this page be appended then?
This page is not appended. It's just for informational,
okay.
Fairly current information for now.
Okay.
Discussion purposes.
Any questions for our town planner? Well, I would entertain a motion then to set this issue to public hearing.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Jordan.
I'll move that we set this to a public hearing on Wednesday, November 13th, 1991, 7:30 Town Hall.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. Any discussion? All those in favor? That is a 7-0 vote. Thank you very much. Okay, item number 81 this evening is to consider setting a public hearing on a proposed new general assistance ordinance and take any necessary action. I will defer to our town manager on this item.
Our general assistance program, which is local welfare, is run primarily at the direction of the Maine Department of Human Services. Each year, the legislature promulgates new statutes, and the agency then defines those statutes to make sure that needs are met. What you have before you is a draft ordinance prepared by the Maine Municipal Association. The only change from it that we have suggested as a staff is that we change the mileage rate that we reimburse recipients for from the proposed 28 cents per mile down to 24 cents per mile, and that is in the draft on page 30. It's already shown that change in your draft. Otherwise, we did not make any suggested changes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Manager. Any discussion on this particular local welfare provision or general assistance ordinance? I would entertain a motion then.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Cogswell.
I move that a public hearing be set for Wednesday, November 13, 1991, at 7:30 p.m. in the Town Hall on the General Assistance Ordinance.
Second motion.
There's a motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor? Vote is 6-0. Okay.
We lost a member.
Well, that happens. Item 82, to consider approving the election warrant for the November election and take any necessary action. I would ask our town clerk, Ms. Pizzo, to update us on this item.
Thank you. In your packet, you folks should have received a copy of the warrant. It does call for a referendum election to be held on Tuesday, November 5th, 1991. The election will be held at the Cape Elizabeth High School Gymnasium. The polls will open at 7 a.m. They will close at 8 p.m. I did want to make a couple of announcements if I could. First of all, absentee ballots are available for those who will not be available to vote on election day. If you'd like to either come into Town Hall or give me a phone call, we'll be happy to send you an absentee ballot. Also, under new legislation, we will be able to open and process absentee ballots after 2 o'clock in the afternoon. This is something that we have worked with Representative Steve Simons, and I thank him for this legislation. It was a compromise, and this will save us time at the end of the evening. Hopefully by 8 o'clock, the absentee ballots will be voted so that we can get a tally quicker than we have been in the past, and I do thank Steve for that. The warrant itself is ready for the council to sign.
Thank you very much, Ms. Pizzo. I would entertain a motion.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor McLaughlin.
I move that we approve the election warrant for the November election on November 5th, 1991.
Thank you. Second that.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor? Vote is 7-0. Thank you very much. Item number 83 is to consider a report this evening from our town manager on the status of the rental units at Officers Row at Fort Williams Park and take any necessary action. Mr. Manager.
While I'm speaking, I'm going to be, it's not that late, I'm going to be passing around a sketch of what a new handicapped access ramp might look like for the former Girl Scout building at Fort Williams. In this past year, we had two tenants at the two rental units at Fort Williams. One was a daycare center, the other was the Girl Scout office. There's new requirements coming down from the federal government in conformance with the American Disabilities Act in that we need to make buildings accessible to the handicapped. In addition, the particular restrictions we have for the use of the buildings at Fort Williams, that they need to be rented out to nonprofit organizations, cultural, philanthropic, et cetera, in nature, requires that almost all of those agencies who would be subject to use of those buildings also must fully be accessible to the handicapped. The issue really comes down to we're rented day one to the building, used to be the Girl Scout building, is, you know, we could do a, you know, what I would call an El Cheapo handicap ramp, or we could do it in a way that would, you know, be a permanent enhancement to the program, to the building, excuse me. And since the building, you know, is going to be here a long time, my sense is that we should do it once and we should do it right. Because of the sensitivity of this structure, I did ask Tom Emery of Tarion Architects, who was working with us on a number of other projects, who would take on this relatively small assignment to design a handicapped ramp. I looked at three or four different schemes. Essentially, what involves is providing the accessibility in the back of the building, where it wouldn't destroy the front facade, that we take the current porch that's on the back, enlarge it and provide a ramp up to it, that the threshold that now as you go in through the building you have to step down about 8 inches, that we remove that so that as you get to the top of the ramp level, it would be a direct at the floor level. It would be removing a few bricks. As you can see, Mr. Emery thinks he's high, and I certainly do when I looked at this estimate. He came out with an estimate including a 10% contingency of $16,306. So, you know, it is not inexpensive to provide for handicapped accessibility. You know, in addition, I should mention that, you know, when the buildings were rented, I mentioned we were going to be doing painting and some other work, and hopefully that'd be covered by the rent, and I think we are breaking even on the rest of it. It's we got a number of proposals for the painting, and I think it ended up about $5,300 for about 60 rooms inside that building of very varying sizes. It's amazing when you get in there, all the different nooks and crannies. In addition, we need to put fire extinguishers. We've had to put emergency lights, you know, things that are very appropriate and proper to do. We've been very careful to have it, you know, inspected and to make sure we fully go up to code. So, you know, as much as, you know, we're in a real tough time economically, I really feel we should go ahead and honor what is now a moral obligation to make a building accessible and what will soon be a legal obligation to make a building accessible by putting in a ramp. It's something, you know, we're going to be dealing with all of our buildings over the next 5 years, and within the next year we'll be appointing you'll need to appoint someone to coordinate accessibility issues, and you know, there are a number of requirements coming out in this American for Disabilities Act. You may have read about it in the National League of Cities Nations Weekly, as well as there was a piece in the Maine Townsman about it. I've gone on for some time. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. Councilor Coxall.
I have two questions. Number one, in the demolition, couldn't we use town employees to take care of the exterior stoop and removing the door and the frame and the canopy and the light? Couldn't we use some of our own employees for that?
There's no reason we couldn't for removing the canopy and light. I'm a little bit nervous because we don't have anyone. There's electrical wiring there. We don't have anyone.
That they could do that, the labor, and perhaps have an electrician come in to do that.
Yeah, we could do some of that.
We could save a little bit of money there. Mm-hmm. Also, you propose paying for this in what is called an overlay account?
Yes.
I've been dealing with overlays in the zoning ordinance and everything else. I'm not familiar with it when it comes to accounting.
Okay. Overlay is the amount that you receive from taxation above what was estimated at the time the budget was adopted. At the time the budget was adopted, you used an estimated valuation of $571 million for the community when that was used from when the budget was first put together in February. Ultimately, when the valuation was finalized, it was $573 million and change. The difference in the total townwide valuation compared to the budget process, compared to what eventually came in, was initially $119,000 in overlay. The overlay is used essentially for three purposes. The first purpose is to provide funds for abatements. And we have had a number of abatements since April 1st, and we continue to expect some additional abatements. A second purpose, which hasn't often been recognized, but which is one that is staring at us, and I got the financial statements from last year, and you'll be getting those very soon, you'll see, is that we have an additional problem with growing late payments and taxes, or what the auditors call deferred revenues. Last year, our deferred revenue increased by $76,000, which was an amount that was not budgeted at all. In addition, we had abatements of about, I think it was about $30,000. So last year we ate up well over $100,000 just in those two categories. The third thing that you use overlay for is unexpected expenditures that occur during the year. My belief is, as long as the economy stays in tough shape, and I had a meeting yesterday with the Maine Municipal Association with the governor yesterday, and he did not give any reasons for optimism. His latest forecast showed a continued downturn over the next two quarters. You know, as long as that continues, I think we need to be extremely cautious at estimating revenues. And you know, it is my intent, I know this is a little off the subject, that we continue to use a one-year lag for valuation. For next year's budget, we'd use what we actually took this year so that we find ourselves in a position to to budget these funds. In addition to that, the auditors specifically recommended in the management letter that as you prepare next year's budget, that you look at these particular issues and give it some tough consideration. So I that was the long answer to your question, but even though we had, I think what I'm trying to say is even though there would seem to be $119,000 there, you've already spent $78,000 to advocate the town's position with the Portland Water District issue, and I'm asking you this evening for an additional, I think it was $17,500 in total. And, you know, the overlay account is just about gone if we continue to have additional deferred revenue. As of the taxes that were due in October, 90% were collected as of this morning, according to a number D. LaBelle gave me, or 89-point-something%. But, the total tax commitment is, what, about $9 million now? So, 10% over the course of the whole year is $900,000. Half of it is $450,000. So, there's a considerable amount outstanding, even though 90 sounds good. So, that's where we stand. That was a long answer to your question, but...
That was complete. Thank you.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Councilor Chappell.
The $16,000, Michael, it says here in Tom's last paragraph, I'll prepare an estimate for our preparation of construction documents once you've confirmed the design. How much might this go with the construction documents? Is that on top of the $16,000?
I requested, I think it was in the agenda, $17,500.
Altogether.
That's what I see altogether, including some of the suggestions that Councilor Cogswell made about us doing.
Have you looked over these individual items? Or,
yeah, I think he's
very high.
Yes, that's. I hesitate to mention them publicly when contractors might be listening.
Well, when you take the means cost estimating guide, right? That fellow Means needs to, put it out.
17.
Yeah. We're in a different economy now, particularly. If more people, I imagine the press covered today.
This will go off a bit anyways.
Oh, yeah, it will be. Yeah. But, you look at the latest economic forecast, and people aren't going to be out spending a whole lot of money.
Okay, well, we've had a very comprehensive response to this particular issue.
Jim, can I ask one more question?
You certainly can.
If we approve this work, will the bid process come back to us for approval later?
No.
Just go right through with it?
That's right.
Well, I would be very interested in putting a little cap on that thing. I don't want it to go 17.5 we're figuring. I think it's way high, but I would cut that down at least 20%.
There seem to be a couple of figures floating around here. The actual recommendation is 16,000 here. I think 17.5 was the COG issue. The 16,000 was the rental units, and I think Councillor Cogswell has very adequately suggested that with the exception of the canopy and light, which is $270, we ought to be able to make back that $1,000 from our very capable public works individuals. So perhaps that could be revised to $15,000 as an outside maximum.
But we also do have about $1,000 in various fees for design. And I also want to have construction oversight services to make sure that this thing is built so that it's there 50 years from now.
So you want to stay with the 16,000?
Particularly since it isn't 17.5, yes.
All right, let's hold to that 16,000 figure for the moment then. And Councilor Jordan.
I'd just like to say Councilor Cogswell reduced it a few hundred dollars, and the manager with his opening remarks felt these estimates were high, so I don't see why you need a 10% contingency in there unless that is for your architectural engineering work. And if that is a cost, I think it should be in the project and not somewhere else. It should be listed here. So I could bring it down to 15,000 easy, not 14.
Are you making a motion, Councilor Jordan?
Yeah. Would you like to have a motion?
I'd be delighted.
Mr. Chairman.
I'd be delighted to have a motion.
I'm in favor of this project, and I think it should be made accessible to handicap and elderly people and what have you. And therefore, I will make a motion that we turn over to the town manager and let him be the general contractor, we might say, to renovate building 326, I believe it is, if I'm not mistaken, to make handicap accessible for the sum of $14,000.
We have a motion. $14,000.
I'll second.
There's a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? Councilor McLaughlin.
A question to Mr. McGovern. Does any work need to be done inside the building for handicapped accessibility?
Over time, some will need to be done. You know, what we're facing is looking at every single one of our buildings, and you know, we're looking at probably hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of cost over the next 5 years. In excess of $100,000 in cost. You know, we have a school department up here on the second floor that isn't accessible. We have an assessor's office that's not accessible. We have a planning office that's not accessible. I think particularly as we have interpretations of the act, you know, this is not only for wheelchair accessibility, it's also for the deaf, for the hearing impaired, and for the sight impaired. There are a number of issues that going to have to be faced. Playgrounds, structures, at the fort, and over at the school grounds, it's going to have a costly impact. So yes, there's more work to be done inside.
You can start giving short answers. Mr. Chairman, I'm uncomfortable with the $14,000 cap because I'm not sure that that's going to satisfactorily include the funds that we may need to expend for construction documents and supervision. The 10% contingency perhaps could be lower than 10%. It could be a 5 or 7% contingency. I'm not, that's just a general policy when you do cost estimates. I'm not sure exactly how much we're going to be saving by using town personnel to do some of the demolition work, and I would say probably some of the proposed other work listed here, but I would be more comfortable with the $16,000 cap.
Mr. Chairman, I'd be more comfortable if we had a bid here that we could vote on. I hate to vote on $13,500, $14,000, $15,000, $16,000. I can't vote with anybody on figures that far apart. I'd like to have a definite bid that I could vote on if that's possible.
Well, I don't think Councillor Chappell, that is possible this evening. We've been in this position before, and I think we've always been very generous in terms of the caps that we've created. I personally am in favor of Councillor Jordan's position. I think if you create a cap of $14,000 and the bids go out, I mean, anyone who's watching tonight who owns a construction company knows that that's the cap, and they've got to come under. If they want the business, they'll come under. If they don't, one of their competitors will. I'm fairly optimistic that we'll get a bid under $14,000 for this project.
Just a point of information, in order to reach the 14 cap, the actual construction bid would have to come in slightly under 13. In order to meet the cost of the services. The other thing I would like to say is, whatever cap you set, if it exceeds the cap, I will be back at the next meeting to try to obtain the difference.
And we are well aware of that. Yes, Councilor Jordan.
Mr. Chairman, as Councilor Cogshaw brought out in number one, as far as the demolition, I can see some of the site work that could be done with our public works. And I'm in agreement with Councilor Chappell about a bid. When we sat here and threw out a figure, and I know there's contractors in the town here probably listening or watching this program, so they're going to come in with that cap regardless, because they want the job, you know, right handy to it. And I think we're telling them how much money is available. I agree with him 100%. They should bid it somehow, then come in and see if we got the money to do it with.
Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, I understand the concern. However, I'm very reluctant to put projects out to bid if I have no sense from the council, particularly if hadn't discussed it in the budget. I don't know if you want to do the project. And, in this case, I understand what you're getting at and all that. But, generally, I don't feel as though I'm authorized to go out and procure services if it's for a project that the council hasn't authorized.
Mr. Chairman.
I'm very reluctant to do that.
May I respond to that
Please.
As far as my opinion? I agree in a sense of what you're saying. Therefore, if you've got a project, I would think that you would come to the council and say, we have a project, and it's estimated it be X number of dollars. And I would think they would tell you to go get a bid and come back at the next council meeting and get it approved. I agree. I don't think you should go out and get bids without authority, but I think you should take one more step within the council. That's the way I look at it.
The only reason I don't do that is because the charter provides that the manager is the purchasing agent of the town, and it doesn't contemplate that the council is going to be directly involved in the awarding of every bid.
May I ask one more question? How large does a project have to be for the council to approve, is what you're saying?
Yeah, the purchasing policy says over $100,000.
So we got to have a bid over $100,000 before you feel you should bring it back to the council. Is that correct? Is that what you're telling me?
I'm saying, I wish to follow the charter. I'm saying I value the council's input, and I'm saying that I don't think the council ought to be involved in the awarding of every bid.
Give me a guideline where I should stop.
$100,000.
Okay.
That's the
then I shouldn't make that motion. Then.
No. The motion you've made, I have no objection to.
Move the question.
Okay. We have a motion and a second. All those. There was a $14,000 cap. All those in favor of the motion? 5. All those opposed? 2. That's a 5-2 vote. The motion carries. Thank you very much. Okay, item number 84 is to consider a request from a citizen to end leaf burning permits in Cape Elizabeth and to take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, I received a letter from a resident of Rocky Knoll Road, dated September 16th. And this person had spoken to me several times over the last few years and had sent about 3 letters. He did call and speak to the town clerk today and just asked, did this, even though, I'd sent him back copy of the memo about the council agenda, he did ask specifically, was it his request that engendered the agenda item to end the leaf burning totally? Because he pointed out that it isn't exactly what he asked. And, so I reread the letter, and I also went back and looked at the record, and I do want to make this clear for the record, is that we did get a letter in 1988 from the individual, which specifically said that there should be no leaf burning in Cape Elizabeth. And in this instance, he did not specifically make that request. But nonetheless, this is an issue that comes up every year. What I'm suggesting that you get public comment on the issue, see what the public thinks, and then perhaps develop ordinance language based on the public's feelings on the issue.
Mr. McGovern, are you suggesting, because we don't have a recommendation formally here, a public hearing on this issue?
Yeah. Yes, prior to the drafting of exact language, so you hear the pros and cons of the issue, and then you can go to work drafting some language if you feel it's necessary.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I've been contacted by a couple of citizens today. I think one of them was contacting other councilors, and that was the person who was encouraging me to ban leaf burning in the town. And the second citizen who contacted me was in favor of leaf burning. So far, folks, it's 50-50 for the contacts I've had. Before we get into drafting ordinances to deal with this, I need to understand how our current enforcement of the situation is working. If this is something that can be dealt with under our current situation as an enforcement issue, that might be one way to deal with a solution. And perhaps Mr. McGovern can address that. How many complaints have there been that kind of thing. This instance here, are we aware that the person who wrote to the council, did he call the fire department with a complaint so that they could go out and enforce the termination time of the permit?
I'm not aware that he specifically complained about that until much, I think he did complain, but it was much later than the time that the permit expired. No one went out at 4 p.m. or 3:03 p.m. to make sure the fire was out. But my recollection is, when I checked into this about a month ago, that there was a complaint, but it was made much later in the day. As to enforcement in general, in complaints, this year we have had very few complaints. Because of the wetness, people just haven't been burning and the leaves haven't come down. Generally, it's over the next few weeks when we begin to get complaints. We tend to get a lot of complaints from the residential neighborhoods with small lots, particularly with trees. We hardly get any from Broad Cove. We get a lot from Elizabeth Farm, from Elizabeth Park. We get a lot of complaints from Cape Cottage Woods, that whole area, and from Brentwood. They will come in. As for enforcement, we go and we do our best to try to get the people to be more respectful of their neighbors. We have reduced quite a bit the times of when we give permits out now.